Well, good morning, everybody. How's everybody doing? I'll give everybody out in the foyer. I see people over there. A chance to come on in. I tried my best to hold off the rain. I did not wash my car yesterday. Last time I washed it, it rained the next day, so I'm trying my best to hold off the rain. Would you stand with me, though? I'd like to read from Psalm chapter 32, verses 1 through 10. It says, "Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up by the heat of summer." Selah. "Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity, and I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin." This morning, it may sound like a downer of a verse, but to me, that is one of the most joyous passages in Scripture. This morning, we're going to start off our service singing about how wonderful and how powerful our God is. The God who created the world, created the universe, put the stars in the heaven, is also the same God who restores us and forgives us our sin and removes our transgressions from us. So if anybody's ever taught their kids geometry, anybody ever had to do geometry with your kids, and you start talking about lines and drawing lines going into infinity, right? You've got these parallel lines. But that is what our sin is like before God. He's removed it. You can't even see it anymore. God doesn't even know anything about it. He's removed our sins as far as the east is from the west. That's why that verse, that passage I just read, is so amazing to me. And it is joyous because he's removed our iniquity from us. Would you turn to a few people, welcome them to church this morning, and we'll get started. Just predict the score for the Seahawks game. How about that?
Thank you.
love. Because when I talked this morning earlier about our sins being removed, it overwhelms me how deep His love is for us. You dance over me while I am unaware. You see all around, but I never hear the sound. Lord, I'm amazed. Lord, I'm amazed.
Thank you. violence in the Old Testament, where Moses is describing to the people of God that the difference between the idols worshipped by the pagans and the God that they served was that he heard them and that he spoke to them. And that is so powerful, because as we look at world events and we look at the newspaper in the mornings, we see school shootings and terrorist attacks, and we see people who have lost their lives in floods in the South, in Florida and Texas, all around the world, people who are experiencing devastation. And in Hebrews, I was reminded of the scripture. It's the first chapter, and the author begins by saying, God spoke to us, to our fathers, through the prophets, in many ways and at many times, but today he speaks to us through his Son, who is the radiance of God and the exact image of God. And we know that we are secure in him through his Son, who he has spoken to, or who has been spoken to us. And so this morning, as we consider our own lives and the way that we're to respond to the world around us, we stand with those who are experiencing destruction. We stand with those who are experiencing persecution, our brothers and sisters around the world. But we don't have to wonder what the message is that we need to bring them. We know the Son. And if we know the Son, we know the Father. And the Spirit works through us to communicate that to them. And I just pray that as a church, through our generosity, through our giving, through our willingness to share our lives with those people, that they would see the Son of God working in their lives. And I pray the same for you, that as we minister to each other, as we use our gifts to honor each other, that we would see the Son of God reigning in our lives, that we would honor him, obey him, out of the love that we have for him and his willingness to sacrifice his life, to die and to rise again. Let's pray as a church over our world and each other. Heavenly Father, we submit ourselves to you. Lord, would you speak to our hearts? Lord, as we read your scriptures, may you speak to us. Father, that you will provide for our every need. Lord, if we feel that we cannot give to others who are experiencing destruction because we ourselves are overwhelmed by the things that have distracted us or by the things that so legitimately have caused us fear or trembling or worry, God, I pray that we would deal with those things, that we would bring them before your throne and know that you have compassion over us. Father, and may your Spirit begin to work in us, begin to set us free of those burdens so that we can walk and show the Son to others, Father, and show them that your yoke is easy, your burden is light, Father, and your Son gives freedom to those who ask for it. Spirit, we thank you for your peace that reigns. We thank you for all that you have done on our behalf. May we remember you always and all the things that you have done to carry us through our lifetime. Lord, we ask today for all of those who are experiencing destruction, Lord, that the compassion that is shown to them, that the resources that are sent out to them, Lord, that you would touch their lives, that the truth of God would be spoken unto them, and that they would receive wholeheartedly your provision, not just for their material things now, Father, but for eternity, that they may have life and have it abundantly. Under the glorious, matchless name of Jesus, we bless you, God, for your work on this earth, and we thank you and we honor you that we have the privilege to be a part of it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you, church. All right, you may be seated. We're going to move into a time of announcements. Thank you, worship team, for leading us this morning in those beautiful songs. So we have a couple things coming up, but before I introduce those things, I'd love to introduce you to our connection cards, which are in your seat back. If you're new here, we just want to welcome you. Thank you for joining us this morning. Thank you for being a part of our family. We honor you, regardless of where you come from. Thank you for joining us. In your seat back in front of you, there's more than likely a connection card. That's just our way of being able to get to know you. If you would fill that out, if this is your first, second, or third time here and you want to connect with us, we'd love to get to know you. Feel free to put that in the drop box in the back. You can put it in the offering bucket towards the end of the service. Or you can meet Wendy, who is one of our deacons. She is an incredible person, such a lovely lady. And you can meet her in the foyer after service. So October is coming up, and we have our Truck or Treat. So we're beginning to take candy donations. They need to be individually wrapped candy donations, but they're for our Truck or Treat event coming up where we minister to our community. We're really excited for that. So if you guys have donations, feel free to drop it off. There should be a box out in the foyer in the coming weeks for that. So this Tuesday, we are having a training for a sound system. I imagine that Cameron will probably be leading that. And it's this Tuesday, September 19th at 6:30 p.m. And we're looking for some new volunteers to help out with sound. We'll train you, don't worry, but pray about it. Ask the Lord if you want to volunteer. We would so appreciate it and would be so happy to have you. Next is our luncheon, Seasoned Saints Luncheon, September 21st at noon. You can sign up in the foyer. We'd love to have you there. This coming Friday is Power Night for our kids, ages 5 to 11 or kindergarten through 6th grade. That'll be this Friday night from 6 o'clock to 8:30. Please pre-register by calling the church to reserve your child's place for dinner. So this morning, if you have any more questions about the announcements, it will be in your bulletin. Feel free to look there. Let's open our hearts as Pastor Daryl brings the word, and let's welcome him up.
Introducing some guests who are with us. We don't introduce all of our guests. However, Destiny's mom, Norma, is here. Would you mind standing and have you do it? And her brother Daniel is here. Let's welcome him. They're up here from the Bay Area, so it's wonderful to have you here. If you're interested, maybe you're not a sound tech that you're interested. One of the most important instruments, we don't think it is it's not a musical instrument, but it is a technological instrument that is used in the service around the world. Sound systems are used to project sound. We don't have the benefit of having the Mediterranean Sea behind us, as Jesus did oftentimes. That would help carry the sound to large crowds of people. So we electronically do that, and if you say I would be interested in learning and being available to help run sound so that people can hear, and we will teach you and guide you and help supervise you in doing that. I've been thinking a lot about heaven. It's not that I'm anxious to go there. A preacher got up to preach one day, and he said to people, how many of you want to go to heaven? And everyone raised their hand except for one man in the back row. And so the pastor was a little concerned, so he said, I say again, how many of you want to go to heaven? Go ahead and stand up. And so everyone stood up except for the man in the back row. And so the preacher was a little concerned. And he said, sir, after everyone was seated, do you not want to go to heaven? He said, oh, I want to go to heaven, but I thought you were putting a load together for this afternoon. My friend who just passed away this last week and went to be in the presence of the Lord, and thank you for many of you who prayed for that family. About a few days before he passed, he made two statements which I think are very, very real when we think about heaven. One was, I'm a little fearful. And two was, I'm at peace and I'm ready to go. Sounds almost contradictory, doesn't it? I'm fearful. I'm at peace. I'm ready to go. But as his two adult daughters, I would say interrogated, but really probably not interrogated Dad, but interviewed him, trying to find out what he meant was. It's the process. Because we have to step through death's door. And all of us, maybe not all of us, but most every Christian understands that death is an enemy that has been defeated. Christ defeated death. He took the sting out of death. And we're told in Matthew and 1 Corinthians 15. But it's the unknown. It's that I believe, but I'm not sure how that process works. That's what he was afraid of. But as far as walking through it, being in the presence of the Lord forever, he was absolutely at peace and ready to go at 64 years of age. And so continue to appreciate your prayers for that family. Their last name is Bowles. So it should, those American people that have good grammar should be able to remember their last name, the Bowles family. So wonderful people. He was a police officer. And more than that, he was a wonderful ambassador for the kingdom of God. So appreciate your prayers. And yes, someone asked me, I didn't see Leah today. And I'm not sure if they meant, I didn't see Leah, I see you, but I'd rather see Leah, or what they meant by that, but that's okay because Leah's in Australia. And so she should be sound asleep. It's the middle of her night down there, and so she should be sound asleep. She went to church yesterday on Sunday, and it's always kind of messes your brain up a little bit. Had a friend who went to Australia, left Los Angeles late in the evening on Sunday night, landed on Tuesday morning, missed his birthday on Monday. Left it up in the sky somewhere. And the international dateline is kind of strange. Leah came to me a couple days before she left, and she was really quite excited. And Leah's not one big on wearing shorts or short pants for whatever her reason is. And she has a drawer that she stores those in. And I said, have you thought about taking some shorts? You know, it's cooled down, it's winter, it's late winter, early spring down there, and then the temperatures are down in the low 80s, mid-80s. And so, have you thought about taking some shorts with you? And she said, I don't like to wear shorts and my legs. And I think she was, yeah. So just to appease my interest, she went and dug around in that private drawer that houses certain clothing that she's less comfortable wearing, I suppose. And she came back to me with an envelope, and she had $200 in that envelope. And she said, look what I found in that drawer where the shorts were. Here's an envelope with $200. What do you think I should do with it? I said, well, you can put it in the pocket of your shorts and take it to Australia. She said, I also found three checks in the drawer that had not been deposited. You should look in that drawer more often. You should wear shorts more often. Think about the money we could have if you just wore them. Isn't it fun when you find money you forgot you had or you didn't know you had? And remember as a kid, I found a dollar bill on the sidewalk. And I just thought I had died and gone to heaven. The whole dollar laying on the sidewalk. I looked all over the place to find out if anybody was close enough to see me put it in my pocket and run for home. I was raised right. Money. Money's not the root of all evil. It's the affection for, the devotion that we give to the acquisition of, the control of, and the disbursement of money is the root of all sorts of evil. The Bible says. However, by the end of the service, we'll give you an opportunity. You can do something glorious with money. We're going to talk about money. Turn to the person next to you and say, oh, we should have stayed on the points to see us, Amy. And then we'll talk about money. Number one cause of marital stress is money. Well, if we just had enough of it, we wouldn't have stress. Well, why is there 75% divorce rate among couples who win a million or multi-million dollar lotto, 75% divorce rate? It's not the lack of money. Sometimes it's too much money. I remember what this last month on the radio. I was driving along, the radio announcer said, well, someone woke up rich this morning. Come to find out, it was a single lady who woke up $720 million richer from the mega ball lotto. Lots of money. We spend our lives, we literally spend our lives, we trade our lives for money. Trade the hours of my day, if I'm an hourly worker, if I'm a salaried worker, or even if I work for myself, like the farmer who goes out and spends his life. I was thinking this morning about the farmers in eastern Washington, the wheat farmers, and how they put in long hours to put in the crop, and nurture the crop, and then harvest the crop, then store the crop, and then pray like crazy that there's a shortage of grain somewhere in the world, and the grain price goes up, and they can sell the crop. So they can plant the crop and nurture the crop and harvest the crop so they can store the crop and sell the crop so that they can plant the crop and nurture the crop year after year after year after year. Money affects every minute of our day. It just does. Every minute of our day is affected by money. Some of you might think, I wish it had a greater effect. Or maybe some of you are thinking, I wish it didn't have such a great effect. But money, access of it. But I mean, think about heaven. What is one of the tangible descriptions of heaven that people use, taken from the scripture, that many people think of when they think of heaven, when they think of some aspect of that eternal place of dwelling? Gold paved streets. Thank you. I didn't even plant you. I didn't give you a slip of paper and say, "Say this." Gold. What is gold? Gold is the world. Basically, it's the world's standard of economy. What is money worth? How much gold is it worth? And somehow, in heaven, the writers of Scripture, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, use that to describe what the streets are paved with. We don't know why it is saying heaven is so opulently compared to what you live with in earth. It's so opulent that what you walk on is what you consider most valuable. We don't know. The Bible doesn't say. But there's some imagery there that's important. But he uses human imagery. And he's gone to prepare a place for me, some translations say. Most of us translate that into a duplex, right? What do most of us refer to as what heaven, my heavenly dwelling is going to be? What's the most common word used?
Mansion.
A mansion. A fellow whose parents were part of this church posted on Facebook this morning. His parents have both died and gone to be in heaven and have their own mansion, but they lived on a piece of ground halfway between here and Redmond up on the hill, the Inglesons. And he wrote, another Microsoft mansion going up on my parents' former property. And it looked like a pretty big box that was going up on their property, a mansion. But if you do a little research, you can almost get discouraged. There's 68,000 millionaires in King County. 68,000 millionaires in King County. That's a lot of money. But Los Angeles County has 254,000 millionaires that live in Los Angeles County. But you got more folk down that way. There's 12 billionaires that live right around us, not all in King County, but within the state of Washington on this side of the Cascades. There's 12 billionaires, and then their combined wealth is $7.1 trillion. Now you're talking real money. Lots of wealth around us, and I imagine some of you have thought, man, there's a lot of money in this neighborhood. Houses selling for $1 million. Property selling for $1 million. I saw a man interviewed on television, him and his wife had built a house in Seattle for only a few, $1,000, under $100,000, and they just sold it for $1.5 million and are retiring. They're moving out of state where the taxes are less. Money can be the focus of our lives. But money can be used. Can you take it with you? The billionaires in our state, $7.1 trillion, can they take any of that money with them? And much has been said, and we usually refer to that at different times when we're thinking about funerals, that not any millionaire asks to be buried with his checkbook or his ledger sheet. They don't ask to go through their finances when they're laying on the bed. The doctor says you have so many hours to live. They ask for people, relationships. So my text today, I've been thinking about heaven. Heaven. And we're just, you know, there's so much about heaven in the New Testament. There's a lot about money. But I'm going to ask you to stand together with me, and I'd like us to read a section of Matthew chapter 6 as you read on the screen, and we'll begin with verse 10. We'll read through verse 21. And the first part of it is prayer. Jesus is teaching about prayer. Second part of it is about fasting. That has to do with setting aside food or other things that are a necessity for you in order to spend time with the Lord. And the third is, what are you doing with your wealth? Notice I changed the language there. Verse 10, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive others, people, when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sin, your Father will not forgive your sins. When you fast, do not look so somber as the hypocrites do. For they disfigure their faces to show others they are fasting. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face so that it will not be obvious to others that you're fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Do not store up your treasures on earth, where moth and vermin destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Lord Jesus, would you take this text as we think about heaven, taking it with us. Lord, help us have a glimpse. Help us have maybe a deeper understanding of what our worship means to you. Whether that's worship in time, or worship in activity, worship in giving, whatever our worship may look like to you, let it be treasure that's stored up in heaven. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Do not store for yourselves treasures on earth. Of the $7.1 trillion that are owned by a handful or a couple handfuls of wealthy people. And in no sense to judge them, but my question is this morning, how much of that wealth has anything to do with the kingdom of heaven? Does it have anything to do with the kingdom of heaven? There is a story told in Luke chapter 16, and Jesus talks about a man Excuse me. Wrong verse. I have a number of passages of scripture. I'd just love to sit down in your living room and go through with you. The Bible talks a lot about rewards. There's a lot about rewards. And you have to understand, salvation is not a reward for your good work. Salvation is a free gift of God. You can't earn it or deserve it. You can't be good enough, do enough good works. Nothing we're talking about today has anything to do with you being forgiven of your sin, being made a child of God. That's your birth into the kingdom of God. But the Bible talks a lot about rewards. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. We're going to talk about, what does it mean to lay up treasures in heaven? What is the value of that? What's the purpose of that? And how do we go about doing that? And again, we'll probably just barely get into it before we have to close it down. But, you know, we can have some influence in what is to come in the future. In Luke, the 16th chapter, the story is told of a man who, it's a parable. Jesus tells a story to teach a lesson. And a simple lesson, but the lesson is this, and that is, the man was not a very good steward of his master's money and his wealth, his grain and his oil and the things that he managed. And the master said, I want you to get the full payment and get it to me quickly. There are like free translation of Jesus' parable. And the steward knew that he didn't have it. So I went out to the guy that owed a lot of money for olive oil, and he said, You owe this much. Tell you what, you write out payment for half of it, and we'll call it good. And then he says to another guy, who owed him a bunch of wheat money, he says, you write out for half of it, and then we're good. And the reason he says this is he says it this way in Jesus' parable. The servant said, I'll give him such a good deal so that when my master kicks me on the street, I'll have a place to stay. This is one of the most peculiar parables Jesus ever tells. It almost seems like he's advocating dishonesty or theft. But he's teaching a lesson. In the parable, you can't take each part and say, well, this is the meaning of the parable. You have to take the parable and find out what the meaning of the parable is. And he's called the shrewd servant. The shrewd servant. So he says, I need a place to stay because the master's going to get mad at me. He's going to kick me on the street even when I give him half of it. And so he comes back in and he gives the master half of the money. And he is commended for his shrewdness. At least he gained half of the debt load and brought it back into the house. And then Jesus goes on to say, I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends. For yourself. Now this is really a strange parable. Use worldly wealth to make friends. For yourself. Because there's a purpose in it. What is the purpose in it? Somebody help me that can read the screen. Pardon?
You will be welcomed into eternal world.
Yeah. Welcomed or invited. Come on over to my place. Wouldn't it be fun in heaven? You go to each other's house, visit one another. Now, isn't that just an odd parable? He uses the story of a shrewd man who's trying to take care of himself, and he wants to have a place of welcome, and he uses money and negotiates the money of his master in order for it to care of himself. And Jesus spins that around and says, you who have money, make friends with non-believers. Buy him a cup of coffee. Take him out to lunch. Take him to a ball game. There was a lady youth pastor in Southern Idaho who wrote a number of books. And she had a ministry of baking cookies and taking to people that lived in her neighborhood who were snarly and hard to get along with. Build relationships with them. them about the Lord. They came to know the Lord. Now, in heaven, so that lady has since gone to be with the Lord. Those people are going to have a mansion just down the street from her. Now, it's not saying use your worldly wealth to gain friends so that you can take care of your own sorry self. It's so that in heaven you'll be invited to people's houses in eternity. Today's Mission Sunday. We give to missions at Neighborhood Church. We have given to missions. It's been one of the bedrock financial issues of Neighborhood Church. It is probably our generosity toward world missions and trying to get the gospel out to people. And we have helped buy trucks for missionaries. We've helped buy bicycles. We've helped given to feeding and clothing programs around the world. Why? So that people come to know the Lord. And just down the street from you, there's going to be someone from Bangladesh. And they'll say, Tom, I knew that you attended that church, and I went and looked at the books up in heaven, and your church gave money to send that missionary, and I understand you gave regularly to the mission program of the church. I want you to come over to my mansion and have dinner with my family or whoever's in that. Use money to build relationships with people around the world. Won't that be fun? Do you know that they are sending, Africa is very active in sending missionaries to America. So is South Korea, though there's not as many South Koreans coming to America, they're going to the northern part of South America to reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And missions is like a great big spider web wrapped around the world, so the people that once we thought were all missionary countries now are missionary sending countries. And we're going to have this wonderful fellowship in heaven, and we're going to be invited to each other's mansions, houses, have fellowship. Use your wealth to make friends. I told you about Howie. Howie was an alcoholic businessman who lived next door to me. Howie liked to swear to see if he could get me unraveled. One day he asked me, he said, do you want a friend or do you want a convert? Like I said, I've shared his story with you. He said, I really would like a friend, but it doesn't bother me at all if you come to know the salvation knowledge of Jesus Christ. Oh, yeah. I think he just liked to rub, you know, hey, Reverend, what blankety-blankety you think about blankety-blankety-blankety. I think he just kind of liked to see if my skin, if he gets a little bit of abrasive on it, probably felt. Called me from southern Idaho. He wrecked the company car because he was drunk. Knew he was going to be fired and his wife was going to divorce him. Can you meet me? They're releasing me from jail. Can you meet me at the airport? Told me his wife's name. Howie's in heaven now. My office, he said, tell me about this Jesus thing. And I'd spent money to spend time with him. I'd spent money to listen to him swear at me. How dumb is that? I wasn't spending money. I was trying to lay up some money in heaven. One of my treasures is when Howie calls me up in his heavenly cell. He says, come on over to my place. Let's have lunch together. Use your funds to make friends so that you too will be invited into. The only thing that makes sense, I've read commentator after commentator after commentator on this one verse. It's a troubling verse because as far as I see, God is preparing a single dwelling place for me and a single dwelling place for you. But in the Greek, it's a plural. You will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Make friends who have dwellings and you get to go to their place. Lay up treasures in heaven. This is a heavenly purpose. To have lunch. I remember being, I was in Falls City, this was a lot of years ago. I was in Falls City and this guy lived out in the valley and he was working in Bellevue. He said, meet me at such and such a place. Now I was raised a teetotaler. I was raised, you you know, you don't even walk on the same side of the street as the tavern. And this guy says, meet me at such and such a place. And it's a bar. So I go there and all of the religious background says, don't go in, let him go to hell. It's okay, you know, it's only one. A lot of people in the world. No, that's not what it said. It said, I care for this guy and he's wanted to have lunch with me, so I went in. Had my diet, Pepsi. Any Pepsi drinkers here? Do I hear a witness? It's hard to be a Pepsi drinker in a Coke world. Use your money. How can I lay money up in heaven? How can I invest in my eternal reward? Use your money to make friends with the ungodly, either in the mission field or somewhere, by helping people to come to know Christ so that they'll welcome you. Oh, they'll know. I think there's a record who is involved in you and I coming to know faith in Christ Jesus. How much is that worth? Amazing. The scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10 says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due to us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10, it says, I've laid a foundation. There's only one foundation, which is Jesus Christ the Lord. And he says, then beware how you build on that foundation, whether you build it by precious stone and precious metals, or you build it with wood, hay, or stubble. It says all of our works will be judged by fire, meaning will it last? And beware, it goes on to say, beware of the one, I should read these to you so maybe you can go home and do your own study. But it says beware how you build on it, because it's all going to be judged by fire, and the one who builds with wood, hay, and stubble, their work will be lost, though they themselves will not be lost. But it says they'll be saved. Again, it's not about salvation. It's about our treasure that we're laying up in heaven. The first passage says everyone will appear before the judgment seat of Christ. I like what one author said, is that the word that is used for judgment seat of Christ is also used in the Greek language of the award platform for a sports event. So it's like the Olympics, and there's an award platform, and the good gifts, the reward for a race well run, is meted out at the judgment seat of Christ. Now Christ has already taken our judgment upon himself, and 1 Thessalonians says we have no fear, there's no condemnation, we have no fear of his judgment against us as sinners. But there is this place where he says, job well done, here's a gold stephanos. Now, the word stephanos means crown. And so does the word diadem. And diadem is a royal crown establishing royalty and rulership. In the kingdom of God, one person wears a diadem, as far as the kingdom of God is concerned. Now, the Bible says in the future we will rule and reign with him, and there's some hint that we might have crowns that are diadems, that are rule authority crowns. But as for right now, only one person wears a diadem, and that's Jesus. He's the king. But he is going to give out awards. Now, I don't know, like in America, they're going to be comparative awards, but they're going to be awards for job well done. Now, whether or not you gave away your $7 trillion. I'm not sure about giving away my $7 trillion, but if you give away your $7 trillion, does it have anything to do with what crown you're going to get? Because if you look at the rest of it, you're going to find out that the value of the gift is the heart in the giving. Paul writes about it in 2 Corinthians chapter 8. He writes about about it in a number of places. We'll refer to another passage in a second from Philippians. And it has to do with that generous heart of happiness, of giving away your time, your talent, your energy, giving away your finances to the cause of Christ. You could put $1 million in an offering somewhere and have no reward at all, and someone else says, Jesus stood at the counter watching people come through the line, and there was a widow that had a fraction of a penny, and she dropped it in the box. And Jesus says she just put more into her heavenly bank account than those that were putting in bags of gold because of her heart. Lord, you've given so much to me. I want to give back to others. And by the way, in so doing, you're laying up treasures in heaven. You're putting treasures in your heavenly bank account. Now, if I get in a contest with Dave, and I say, Dave, I'm going to put more in my account than you put in your account, that's pride. And probably all my work is wood, hay, stubble. Because it's earthly and fleshly, competitive, win value system. Rather than, Lord, you've given so much to me, how can I help but to give back to you? How can I help but be generous back to your cause, your work, your kingdom? Oh, there's so many verses, so many texts. The Bible's full about rewards that we are going to receive. But we won't read that. Let's go back to the first verse. The context of writing, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth. That's not saying don't have a bank account. There was one other story I was going to say from Scripture. There was a man. There was a rich man, Luke chapter 12, verses 13 through 21. There was a rich man. And he had filled up all of his barns. And it was so full, there were still crops in the field. So he said, I'll tear down all my barns and I'll build little barns, bigger barns, stronger walls, stronger barricades. And I will save up all this money for me so that I will be set for life. Parable, Jesus. And Jesus calls him foolish. The word foolish is not meant to be crass or insulted. Foolish means without understanding, without proper understanding. Same thing the word vanity means, foolish. Because he said, don't you understand that today, this day, right now, tonight, you're going to be in eternity. Been so busy storing up money, earth money, so that he himself was going to be okay. Nothing wrong with a retirement plan, nothing wrong with a 401k, then it's not saying that, is it? But he put all of his faith in his finances and not in God. And it doesn't say that he was generous with anyone, with his finances, or with his time, or with his property. And by the way, generosity with others, especially needy people, works its way way back into the Old Testament. And even the covenants of God, Israel, the God's covenant of Israel with the land was, they were not to glean the corners of the field, and they were to leave a certain amount of grain in the field for the sojourners, the ones who didn't have a home, that they would have a place to go and get some food to eat. And Israel was supposed to be, and one of the judgments against Israel was that Israel became this man who had a barn full of food and was not generous with the needy people around them. Israel was always told, be generous. Give, and it will be given back to you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Pushed down, shaken down, and it'll be running over. Now don't get the idea. There's a couple different ideas that gets really confusing here. One is I'll give in order to get. And that's not biblical. If I give generously, the Lord will give back to me. That's biblical. But If I give in order to get, that's an investment program. If I give with no expectation of getting anything back in the generosity of God, He gives back to me, that is grace. Working both ways. And what are you doing? You're laying up treasures in heaven where it can't be stolen. Argentina flew through my mind, and the inflation that took place in Argentina back in the, what was it, 70s? 70s or 80s? No, it would have been in the 80s. Maybe 90s. 80s, I think. I talked to a youth pastor who's down there, and he says, it's great because I could buy a steak for $1.50, but people got paid at the end of every day. The inflation was so bad in Argentina for a season that people were paid daily because tomorrow the money would not be worth what it was today because inflation was. Money can disappear so fast, the earthly money, but heavenly money, that is, unless you hide it in your drawer where you keep your shorts. Money can disappear, that we, and so can time, and so can energy, that we try to keep on this earth. But as we do it with a heart, say, Lord, I want to bless you. I want to bless you with my will. I want the name of Jesus to go farther and faster around the world and around my neighborhood and throughout my community. So Lord, I'll invest in the church missions program. I'll invest in this outreach program that's coming up at the end of October. I will invest some time, some energy, some resources. I will invest. I will happily and freely give in order that other people will come to know grace. And I'll get invited to their house in heaven. Amen?
Amen.
So he's talking here. Jesus is talking here. He's not talking about keeping the law. He's talking about works of righteousness. In this passage of Matthew chapter 6, he's talking about acts of righteousness, things that every follower of God should do, things that should be involved in your life. And he never says if, he always says when. And there's four things that he says that we all should be involved with. And this is the capstone of that. Actually, there might be five, but there's four things that he says all of us should be involved in the good works of these. When you give to the needy, verse 2. So when you give to the needy, that's called almsgiving. When I give to help others by giving generously to them, do it in such a way that you don't get the fanfare. By the way, he says, people that do these four things in order to get people's approval, that's their reward. When people say, oh, that's all your reward you're going to get. But if you do it with a heart to the Lord, I don't care, this person needs this, I'm going to give it because they need it, whatever it may be. And Jesus comes back and says, I saw that. I saw you sneak over to their house and give them groceries. Met a young lady in her first church, got saved. She was a prostitute. And she wore very nice clothes, very nicest clothing to church that she had. And it was very revealing clothing. But she was so excited to know Jesus that that was the very best dress she had in her whole closet. She just wanted to dress up as nice as she could. She knew it was inappropriate. A lady in the church took her shopping. She was so excited. She didn't have any money. Drug addict, prostitute, bought her a dress. Nobody knew about it. You know about it now, but you don't know who it was. But I think when Jesus comes back and he gives out rewards, he's going to say to that lady, I saw you buy her dress. A nice dress, good job. Here's your reward. How many want to get a reward when Jesus comes down? Oh, come on! Come on! When you give your alms, when you pray, prayer includes singing and worship. It includes you coming to church and lifting your voice with all the rest of the saints and singing with all of your heart, whoever's leading songs or whatever the style is, with all of your heart, You sing a prayer and a praise to God. You're laying up a treasure in heaven. Because God wants it. And when you pray, don't stand on the corner and try to be seen by people. Don't do it in order to be self-centered, because if that's what you are after, that's what you, that will be your reward. When you fast, we read that part, when you fast, so we have when you give and when you pray and when you fast. Do it in such a way that people don't know that you're fasting. Now, if your stomach growls, you're no control over that, but it doesn't say don't put ashes on your head and walk around acting like you're being religiously fasting. You know, comb your hair, wash your face. Go about your duties, but your fasting is unto the Lord because you're so hungry for Him and desiring to please Him and desiring to have good things happen in other people's lives. You set aside food or drink or something in order to separate yourself to God. When you do these acts of righteousness, do them unto the Lord, not unto people. Your Father sees, He will reward you. By the way, in each one of these it says your Father will reward you. The one that may or may not be might be the one about forgiving. Forgiving is a big deal to God. Forgiving is a huge deal to God. Mm-hmm. When you forgive people, you lay up treasures in Him. And then He says, don't let all your storage be on earth. Store up your treasures in heaven. Because where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. And where your heart is, that's where your treasure is. And when Christ returns, there's going to be a reward. So if your heart is, Lord, I just want to take of the good things you've given to me and give them to other people. Freely give what you've freely received. Amen? Freely give what you freely receive. Give it away. Just try to give it away. You will. I just don't think you'll ever run out of what God has given to you if you freely try to give it away. One last scripture as the ushers come to the front of the building. We're going to close the service by giving you an opportunity to give. And you can give by check, money order. You can give by bag of gold, you can give by half a penny. You can give in the foyer. If you're not prepared to give, you can go online at bnc.org and you can give. You can lay up treasures in heaven. If your heart's right, if you want to honor the Lord with the giving what He has given to you, you want to give back to Him. Now, I'm going to read this passage of Scripture from Philippians. If you read in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, you'll find that Paul writes a letter and commends the church because of their generosity to the work of the Lord. And he says that God's going to pay you back. God's going to bless you in what you've given. And to the Philippian church, he says, many Christians like to quote a certain portion of this passage, but you need to read the whole passage to understand. Verse 14 says, yet it was good of you to share in my troubles. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of my acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out from Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, except for you only. For even when I was Thessalonica, you sent me aid again and again when I was in need. Not that I am looking for a gift, but I'm looking for what may be credited to your account. He said the money was good, but even what's better is you're going to get a reward from that. That's on your account. You were generous with the work of God and with the mission. Yeah. invest because people need to know the gospel. Invest because it will go on your account, not earthly account to speak of, but your heavenly account. Then Paul goes ahead and says, I have received full payment, and even more, I'm amply supplied now that I have received your received from Epaphroditus the gift you sent. You are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice, pleasing to God. And my God will meet all of your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. So as we give, would you stand and sing along with those that are leading us in worship today, but give liberally and give generously to the work of the Lord. Every time you're given an opportunity, give to individuals your time, your energy, your talent. Give away what you want to receive back. By the way, something I was saying. Give away what you would like to receive back. Now, you say, Daryl, that's not biblical. Yeah, it is. It says that we are to give. You know, the golden rule of the scripture. We'll receive what we give. Lord, thank you that we have an opportunity to invest in heaven. Many different ways, including financial. So Lord, receive our gift today as a God-honoring, Christ-worshiping act of worship that invests in the kingdom of heaven.
As close.
leave this building today, we just pray. This week you'd give us many opportunities invested in heaven. Lord, with our attitude, with our demeanor, with our generosity of heart, Lord, give us many opportunities to invest in the kingdom of heaven, I pray. Lord, not so that we would receive a reward, but thank you that you promised us a reward that is to come. Dismiss us now in the name of mercy and grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So I encourage you to go out and give it away. Wherever you might go, watch out the Lord.
You as well.